Let's start with a prayer, please. Heavenly Father, Creator of the universe, we ask your blessings on us today. We ask you to keep our minds and hearts open to your wisdom and to your holy will. Help us, Almighty God, to understand you, to know you, and to appreciate all the love that you give us. This we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
So I want to ask you, what are some of the things that you think hinder your spiritual growth? If anybody has anything they want to just say it.
My own mind.
What was that?
My own mind.
Okay.
Repeat what he said.
What's that?
Repeat what he said. Can you repeat what he said?
Oh, I couldn't even hear it.
Oh. His own mind.
His own mind.
You don't have any microphones, okay. So it's kind of hard to... And I have to say that that is a good point, because it's our mind that really hinders us.
That's true.
For believing in everything.
All right.
For believing.
I think it's a lot of times it is. It's fear, it's anxiety, it's worry. But a big one that I want to talk about now is about guilt and not forgiving ourselves. I think that's a huge hindrance to us. Some of us tend to be perfectionists. We're our own toughest critics. And some of us have low self-esteem. But here's the turning point. Even after we accept in our hearts that God has forgiven us, excuse me, we start to have doubts about whether we should forgive ourselves. We feel guilt. We may not admit it openly to others. Oftentimes, we put on a happy face when we're out in public and keep our real feelings to ourselves. We can't find that peace that comes with forgiving ourselves. Oftentimes, we let the evil spirit tell us, yeah, but, to anything. Yeah, but God forgave you this time. He might not next time, and you're just going to commit the same sin again, so why even try? Unfortunately, we often tend to listen to that talk, and so inside us there's a lot of turmoil. I want to tell you a story from my own life. I used to be a seminarian. I was once Catholic, so I was studying for the priesthood. And one of the times I was in the seminary, one of the things they had us do was to do what's called pastoral ministry. So they'd assign you to either a school, a nursing home, or whatever, where you do your ministry for the summer. Well, I was assigned to be a hospital chaplain at this one hospital, and I have to say a side point here. That hospital was the one I was born at. And I thought, wow, you know, this is amazing. The hospital I was born at, and now I don't know how many years later, they're assigning me to be the chaplain at this hospital. So I went into this room with this one woman that was lying in bed, and she had her husband next to her, and we were just engaging in small talk, and after a while she said, well, would you pray for me? And of course, you know, I held her hands, I prayed for her. And then after that was done, I don't know what moved me, but something inside, I think it was the Holy Spirit just telling me, I turned to her husband, I said, I'd like to pray for you too. The answer he gave me, now you think he'd say, well, sure, why not? He was like, and I'm paraphrasing because I don't remember his exact words, but don't bother praying for me. I've sinned too much in life. I've done so many bad things when I was younger. He said, just forget it. Don't even bother wasting your prayer. Well, I don't know about you, but one of the things, when I hear that, the first thing I want to do is pray for them even more. Okay? So I did pray for him quite a bit. Then afterwards, when I was reflecting on everything that happened, I remember I was praying about it, and the words that came to me were, God will definitely forgive this person, but can this person forgive themselves? And that was just so profound. You know, I was stunned by this person's response, but even the great apostle Paul looked at his past with great regret. He said, For I am the least of the apostles, who am not worthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. Paul wrote these words about 20 years after his persecution of the early Christians, and they indicate that he had no means forgotten his shameful and destructive past. The Bible shows us that Paul left that life behind and went on to lead a much more constructive and productive life. What can we do when guilt and regret about our past actions keep us from moving on with our lives and going forward as we should? The Bible doesn't directly speak about forgiving ourselves, but it does give us a blueprint to follow. The life of Manasseh, the king and king of Judah, is very instructive about how God views a repentant sinner. Manasseh was the son of righteous King Hezekiah, who was generally considered to be one of the best kings of Judah. Manasseh, on the other hand, was considered to be among the worst. Ironically, his reign over Judah was the longest of any king's, 55 years. What's interesting about him, too, is he was made king when he was 12 years old. The Bible lists some of the evil deeds of King Manasseh in 2 Chronicles. It begins by telling us that Manasseh did many evil things in God's sight. He rebuilt the sites of pagan worship that had been torn down by his father. This blows me away. He sacrificed his own children in idol worship and consulted mediums. How can you sacrifice your own kids? Verse 9 finishes by saying that Manasseh seduced the people of Judah to do more evil than the pagan nations that surrounded them. That itself is a terrible indictment. According to the Jewish historian Josephus, Manasseh was responsible for a great deal of bloodshed among those who tried to follow God. For by setting out from a contempt of God, he barbarously slew all the righteous men that were among the Hebrews. Nor would he spare the prophets, for every day slew some of them, till Jerusalem was overflowing with blood. Finally, after Manasseh was taken prisoner, he took stock of his actions and repented of his sins. What was God's response at the enormity of Manasseh's sins and wickedness? He saw Manasseh change of heart and heard his cries. He received his appeal and restored Manasseh to the throne in Jerusalem. Even if the sins of Manasseh were so great that God could still forgive him, how do we know he forgave himself? We don't really. But by his actions, Manasseh demonstrated his genuine change of heart because he destroyed all the places of idol worship and rebuilt the altar to God. He demonstrated a positive response to his past. It's kind of hard to imagine a more guilt-ridden past than Manasseh. Just think about the enormity of his crimes and his sins, and I keep going back to the fact that he sacrificed his own children. I can't believe that. It makes you wonder how he felt and thought about himself, even after he repented. In another example, we see in the Gospels about Judas and Peter, how they took two different paths. Judas had extreme guilt after betraying Jesus, and instead of repenting, he goes out and he hangs himself. Peter denied Christ three times. He wept and was sorry for what he did. He did not choose to leave the fold nor kill himself. Instead, he sought Christ's forgiveness. Now, there are three ways we can move towards self-forgiveness and self-healing. I know there are many other ways, but these are the three I've cited. The first way is that we refuse to compare ourselves to others. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12 says, "Not that we dare to classify or compare ourselves with some of those who are commending themselves, but when they measure themselves by one another and compare themselves with one another, they are without understanding." Many times we say that, "Oh, we're not as good as so-and-so, and they were so blessed by God and we're not, we don't understand, or else we feel unworthy of God's blessings. But God has forgiven and blessed others, and He will bless us too. We can't be so hard on ourselves and have the feeling of guilt within us. We have to release that. I could probably use anybody as an example. I'd use Scott, but I don't know all the struggles that he went through in his life. I may just see his success, his average success, but I don't know all the trials, the tribulations, the suffering that he went through during his life. All I see is, oh wow, you know, he's got so much success and he's a very prolific speaker and all of that, but I don't see what he went through before that. And that's what we have to keep in mind. We can't compare ourselves with other people. We don't know the struggle that they went through. Brothers and sisters, we are all in this together. Some people are better than us in some things, but they're worse than us in other things. Realize that the same mistakes and sins that you went through, other people have very similar. In the Gospel of John, chapter 21, Jesus and Peter were talking. Peter saw that the disciple whom Jesus loved was following them. When Peter saw him, he asked, "Lord, what about him?" Jesus replied, "If it is my will that he should remain here, what is that to you? Your job is to follow me." What Jesus is saying is, don't worry about your fellow Christian. Worry about your own faith walk. Now, it doesn't mean that we don't look out for each other, we shouldn't pray for each other, we shouldn't do all things to edify each other. It just means don't judge or compare with one another.
Amen.
I remember how many times Don and I instruct Natalie, don't worry about what so-and-so did, just worry about yourself. But we have to take that to heart too. We have to worry about ourselves and then take care of other people. If we're not healed, we can't go about healing other people. The second way towards self-healing is we need to let go of the past, focus on the present, and plan for the future. The plans for the future can go awry at any time. Dawn and I were in a car accident not too long ago. And we had plans that day. We had plans, I believe, to go out with friends of ours. Those got changed in an instant as soon as we got rear-ended by another car. So while we can plan for the future is unsure. The past we have to let go because it might have an emotional stranglehold on us. It doesn't mean that if you have good memories of the past, you can hold on to it. But what I'm referring to are the sins, the mistakes we have made, and the emotion that brings. It oftentimes strangles us and prevents us from progressing in a spiritual way. Winston Churchill said, "Success is stumbling from failure to failure with no loss of enthusiasm." The only thing we should do with the past mistakes, sins, and failures is to reflect on what we could have done differently. If you know that God loves you enough to forgive you anything, then you need to love yourself in a healthy way, forgive yourself, and move on with your life. In 1505, a 21-year-old young man was walking toward a village when the sky became overcast. A raging storm blew up and a bolt of lightning lit the sky. With a flash, it knocked him to the ground. He thought he was going to die. This man had grown up in a medieval culture that was filled with talks of devils, demons, heaven and hell, and the great judgment day. A culture of great fear. He thought that the lightning had been launched at him by an angry God as a glimpse of the terror of judgment. Who was this young man? Does anybody care to guess? He was Martin Luther. Martin struggled with his own guilt, and in his own words he said, "I was miserable and a little pygmy, dust and ashes and full of sin, daring to speak to the living, eternal, and fearsome God." Martin's experiences capture his own terrible internal burdens and feelings of guilt. He got to the point where he was so convinced that God was pure and holy and judgmental that no one could ever hope to be saved. All would be abandoned to eternal torment. He said, "More than once I was driven to the very abyss of despair, so that I wished I had never been created. Love God? No, I hated him." Then in 1513, he grasped that the justice of God is that righteousness by which grace and sheer mercy God can justify us through faith. Whereas before the justice of God filled him with fear and hate, now it became to him inexpressible joy and love.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, when we fear God and his punishments, like Martin Luther once did, and do not think we can be forgiven, aren't we really just struggling internally with ourselves and refusing to forgive ourselves? The last point in the number three in the self-healing pretty much goes without saying, that we need to pray and read Scripture and use Scripture as prayer. We can use God's word repeated to ourselves to give us the power to self-heal and move on. Repeat this after me. I can. Do all things. Through Christ.
Who strengthens me. Amen.
That is powerful. That happens to be my favorite scripture verse. Just so you know.
Where is it found?
In Philippians 4:13. I often repeat it as a prayer and help me overcoming guilt and give confidence. I do have a handout sheet. What does my time look like?
Time.
I listed the scripture verses on the bottom that I most of which I was using in this talk. You may have seen this before, but this is, for me, it's very powerful. I use it quite a bit myself. I'll wait till everybody gets a sheet. Everybody have one? These are affirmations of God's power. They are meant to inspire us, to bring hope and healing. We could say it together. Why don't we also say it together? God's strength is greater than my weakness. God's mercy is greater than my sin. God's joy is greater than my depression. God's healing is greater than my suffering. God's hope is greater than my despair. And I just left it blank. You can fill in your own. If anybody has something that's not on here, you want to share it, feel free to do so now. These were my own personal favorites, so that's why I included them. If not, we can move on.
God's consistency is greater than my inconsistency.
There you go. That's excellent. So you can fill in with anything you want, but it's to me it's just empowering. I mean, it sounds simplistic, but
it's
like to say it. Pardon me?
It's empowering.
It is. And my favorite one is the one right at the top. God's strength is greater than my weakness. Because it relates to this talk. We're weak. We're in despair. God's strength is going to get us through it. I just want to conclude with. This is from Philippians chapter 3, verses 13 through 14. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things that are behind me and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press forward toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
I believe song, Call on Jesus.
You know, sometimes you don't know what your day is going to be like. Most of the time, you don't know what your day is going to be like. But if you set out and every day and say, God, use me, you have to be prepared to be used. I bring that in because I really wasn't aware I was going to do the kids today and do this. So if you guys can be just a small bit patient with me, I've asked God to come in. I'm going to pray, and I'm going to ask him to sit me down and so that he rises up so that the message that he imparted in me would definitely impart in your heart. So with that, I want to pray in. Father, I come to you today, Lord. I come to you, Father God. I'm just thanking you for the privilege and opportunity to stand in front of these people, Father God, and to stand in front of these servants of yours, your children, Father God, to be able to impart a message of forgiveness, God. I thank you, Father God, for how you have blessed this place, Father, and how you have set your will to be done here, Lord. And I thank you for even bringing me here so that I can be used as a vessel. Because I am asking that you use me as a vessel, God. I'm asking you to fill me up with you and remove anything that's not like you. God, I ask you to forgive me for anything I may have said or thought that brings anything that does not represent you. And it's in your matchless name I pray. Amen. Colossians 3 and 13 speaks, there's a verse that says, forgive each other as Christ has forgiven you. That forgiveness, I didn't get to hear his portion, but I know it was phenomenal, is it's just a dynamic that a lot of us have an issue with, which is true, because in order for you to fall into a category of wanting to forgive, somebody has had to do something detrimental. There has to have been some type of pain, some type of life-altering situation going on with you. I want to tell you a story really quickly. My daughter was murdered in 2008, and it was a domestic violence situation. Prior to her being murdered, there was another situation that went on with her with another family member, and I went to go and save my daughter. I was in Illinois. She was in Iowa. She called me crying. This person had really, really hurt her. And so I was upset. I've been Bible-toting, loving the Lord, devout Christian since I was 7 years old. But on that day, you hurt my baby, and I was ready to start a prison ministry. I promise you on everything, if I had seen him, it was not going to be nice. So here I am coming from Chicago, coming to Iowa, geared and packed and ready to do whatever I have to do because you hurt my child. My child is crying. She's hurt. She's in the hospital. You hurt my child. I get to my daughter, and the first thing she says after she hugs me, and she's still trembling, is she says, Mom, I need you to forgive him. I have already forgiven him. Now, mind you, the incident did not happen to me. It was my daughter. But for her to take the stance and to tell me that she had already forgiven him, and she did that, and she didn't say it was because I said did it, to do what she did it because she said he had a sickness. And if you don't forgive him, you will be sick. You don't forgive because of them. You forgive because you need to move on, Mom. And now I've been telling her this. I really have been telling her this. I would like to think I told her that a couple times. I'm the mother. Christian, I would have told her that. But that didn't resonate in my spirit until I lost my daughter. And I had to forgive the young man who took her. Now I'm very transparent. Those that know me know that I'm extremely transparent. And so I'm very transparent when I tell you that it took a long time for that to happen. And at first, I did not want to do it. But I came across this in this scripture once in my regular devotion. And forgive each other as Christ has forgiven you. And then I thought about this. I thought about what I was doing by not allowing myself to let go of something that actually was the most horrendous thing that could have happened to me in my life. No one wants to bury their child. But then I thought about what it was doing to my life. I realized that I had to really forgive him, and it had nothing to do with him. I wanted to live life abundantly. John 10:10 tells us that the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. This is NIV version. It says, I've come that they may have life and have it to the full. The King James version is the one I love because it says that I come that they might have life and that they might have it abundantly. Abundant life. Abundant life living is one of the reasons that forgiveness is very important. Forgiveness gives you access to abundant life. When you think of abundant life, you think of expectations of, you know, prosperity and health and you know, fancy cars and, you know, living life to the fullest. When I think of abundant, I think of being able to digest the day by day going on and still have peace and I'm still sane. My abundant life scenario would be that whatever is going on, what life is tossing me, then I'm able to face it in hope and trust in God. One of the ways that we can do that is, and I love to talk, but I also like to back it up. I'm a research student, and I love to back up whatever I say with the word, so I'm going to throw out some scriptures to you guys. But John 15:7 tells us that if you remain in me, and my word remains in you, you ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. If I am expecting for Christ to give me the abundant life because of the promise of if I forgive, this abundant life comes to me, then I have to remain in him, and I have to trust him. I have to keep his word in front of me. You're going to take delight in the Lord. That's Psalms 37:4. Take delight in the Lord, and he'll give you the desires of your heart. This is coming along with the abundant life scenario. You may say, then what does that have to do with forgiveness? What does taking delight in the Lord have to do with forgiveness? Well, delighting in the Lord is simply, for me, following his will. I'm delighting in what the Lord says. I'm going to follow his will. And his will is that we daily forgive others. Daily, Lynn. Daily? Yeah, daily. Forgiving daily was so important to Christ that he laid out principles of it in his prayer, in the Lord's Prayer. Matthew 6, and as I'm telling you guys these, trust. I'm a research student, but you can Google me. If you don't want to open your Bible, you can Google whatever I'm saying to you. I would add more to it before I would buy a Bible. But Matthew 6 spoke on the principles of prayer. And he gives an example of how we can effectively speak to him. And you know, prayer is just literally dialogue with God. We do know that. Right? Okay, show of hands. Prayer is just dialogue. Very good. Glad y'all still here with me. This is one of the guidelines that he wants us to have to effectively speak to him, to move him to access the abundant life. I'm going to give you a couple examples. At the beginning of it, he literally tells you, look, this is how I want you to pray. He says he wants you to reverence him because you're going to start it off with our Father in heaven. Hallowed be your name. Hallowed is holy. So you're going to reverence him. You get a person's attention when you reverence them. Then you're going to say, you're going to recognize him or recognize that you are his servant and that you are his servant, not to his will in your life. When you say to him, your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So you've given him reverence, and you've told him that I want your will to be done in my life. You're going to let him know that you're going to decree and declare that you trust him to supply you with your daily needs. Give us this day our daily bread. But then on top of that, you're going to say to him, God, yep, I want you to forgive me as I forgive forgive others daily. I'm going to show Christ to that person that hurt me by forgiving them. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. But Matthew 6 goes on to say it, and when you're reading the Bible, all the time I would suggest that you go before the verse that you pick out and after the verse, you can get what was going on and what was said afterwards. And so further down in chapter 6, he says that if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father won't forgive you your sins. I was thinking about that. I was thinking about what reciprocity is. And, you know, reciprocity is the exchange of between two people. In the simplest form, it's a situation or a relationship in which two people or groups agree to do something similar for each other, to allow each other to have the same rights. reciprocal arrangement. When I was thinking about this, I was trying to think, okay, how can I break this down? So, like, if I come to your birthday party and I bring you a gift, when you come to my birthday party, show of hands, what do I want?
A gift back.
Now we're going to put a pin. Can I put a pin there, Sharon? We're going to put a pin right here. Yeah. I'm going to give you examples of something that just, to me, does not represent reciprocity. The Secret Santa parties.
Oh, yeah.
Secret Santa parties. Do not force Lynn to be in a Secret Santa party because I never get the gift that I'm looking for.
Right.
The last time I was in a Secret Santa party, I was at a corporate event. I was site director at a school. You would think they would give me something. You would think these people were educated enough to know that Lynn didn't drink. Why did I go out and get this lady who I kind of knew she wanted this? So I bought her $25 is what we were supposed to spend. I bought her a $25 Starbucks gift card. Yeah, and got the box to go with it, so I put an extra little $2 or $3 with it. The person that was buying my gift didn't show up. So I got the extra gift. Oh, it was really cute. The box was really cute. It was a box. It was a really nice gift box with two pretty thick drinking glasses and a bottle of dark liquor. What's that gonna do for me? I ain't getting drunk today. What is? I was like, are you kidding me? Reciprocity. I'm gonna pull that pin out, Sherry, because I'm really letting the pin. I'm gonna pull it out. So I'm pulling the pin out. When I pull the pin out, I want to stop and say something that really has no scripture backing, but it means something. But now I'm putting it back in because I'm coming back to the word because I think I got 5 minutes. Forgive. So you want to forgive because it gives you a sense of peace. So we've already talked about forgiving because that's what Christ does. We also talked about forgiving because it gives you access to abundant life. We talked about, now we're going to talk about forgiving because it gives you a sense of peace. I was researching a couple days ago when I was thinking about this thing. I thought I saw it somewhere, but I want to make sure that September 21st, which is actually my anniversary, is the Day of International Peace. You guys know that? Mm-hmm. Okay, the Day of International Peace. On this particular day, there is a peace campaign, and it's devoted to strengthening the ideals of peace for the nations and the people. So a lot of leaders get together, and they have created this thing called a peace campaign, Forgive for Peace. And what has happened is that leaders have found out that the first step on the path to peace begins with what? Forgiveness. Can you imagine getting up every morning, picking up a book bag with 50 pounds of rocks in it? Carrying unforgiveness is like carrying that bag around on your back every day. Habitually, you get up. And I say habitually because once you allow it to put itself in, it's part of you. You get up every morning, grab it before you brush your teeth and comb your hair, and take your day and do whatever you have to do in your day. And a lot of times what we do is we do it because we are afraid of facing it. We are afraid that if I am wasn't transparent enough that somebody else will hurt me. That's not peace. We're not living in peace. I had a friend come over for the holidays, and while she was there, I really thank God that she came, because she was at my house when she got the call, and she got the call that her sister had passed. And the thing that bothered her the most about her sister passing was that they had no true relationship. Years ago, she did nothing. She was just happened to be born. It was one of those situations where there were two different fathers, and so the mother, you know, way back in the day when you had a baby without being married, they would take in the South, they would take the baby, and grandma would raise the baby. So that's what happened. So this sister was raised, and they just thought she was a cousin. And so when she found out, she was mad at everybody. And so when their mother passed, she told everybody, I don't have anything to do with you guys. But when she cut off the family, she began, that bitterness had already set up, and she was a mean, cantankerous, hard to deal with Christian. I don't know if you guys know anybody like that, because I know you all don't know any mean people that say they Christians now, because I don't even know where I would say something like that, but that's what she was. And she passed by herself. She passed alone. She had two kids. She had pushed them out the picture. That's not living an abundant life. That's not abundant life. Love, the forgiveness, again, is the highest form of love. I read somewhere that there's no love without forgiveness, and there's no forgiveness without love. I think this guy's name is Brian McGill. You guys know him too. I read that song on a post, and I thought that was really cute. I was going to put it on a t-shirt. But forgiveness is the highest form of love. How is that, then? Well, 1 Peter 4:8 tells us to love all. Love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. You say that a person hurts you and you can't get past the pain. I say that if you allow God to work in your behalf, then he'll bring you to a place of restoration just because of your faith in his ability to do so. Your steps towards forgiveness returns the power that you gave to the other person. When they were holding on to your past, it gives you back the power. See, when you allow unforgiveness to root up, you have given that person power over you. How do I know that? Be mad at somebody long enough that you don't want to be around them, and see what happens when they come around you. Your body, you get sick to the stomach, you get a headache, you can't stay. Oh, I can't stay for this dinner because JoJo came home. No, no. We are living to be, we represent Christ. We have a promise of abundant life. Why do we hold back our promise of abundant life? By allowing things from the past, which could be very, my daughter was murdered, very legitimate. I have a legitimate reason to hate him forever. Except, guys, he died the same day my daughter died. So who do I hate? So I'm angry for what? Who am I angry at? So I'm sick, I'm losing hair, I'm gaining weight and losing it, can't keep food. Why? Why? That's not abundant life. I don't even, so all that is consuming me, and I don't even have time to go and do what God put me here for. And that's to love and to show and draw people to him. Ephesians 4:32 tells us to be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. God set the standard, people. He gave us the ultimate example. He sent his son to die on the cross for me, for you, for sinners. God is awesome. I know he did something I could never do. I don't know about you all. I don't know. Maybe y'all got a little more sage juice than me. I don't know. I couldn't have done it. People who have nothing to do with him, people who just ignore him, he sent his son to die for them. He did that to show us how much he loved us. And guess what? He loved us at our darkest, nastiest, filthiest hour. But he loved us. God demonstrates his love for us in that while we were we're still sinners, Christ died for us. That's Romans 5:8. And guess what else he did, guys, before I close this out? You're never going to believe this. Hold your feet. Just hold your feet. When he forgave you, he forgot about it. He forgot about it. JoJo slapped me when I was in third grade, and I had this whip. I got this whip on my face, and he forgot about it. Oh, no, 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 he did. He took my child from me, and I'm so without my child. He forgot about it. He cheated on me. I gave him all my life. I gave him 100% of me. He forgot about it. See, when he forgives, he does the ultimate. He lets it go. Micah 7:18-19 says, that is the international version, that who is a God like you who pardons sin and forgives the transgressions of the remnant of his inheritance? You do not stay angry forever, but delight to show mercy. You will again have compassion, on us, and you will tread our sins underfoot and hurl all our iniquities in the depths of the sea. Isaiah says a little shorter than that. He says, I who blot out your transgressions for my own sake and remember your sins no more. I always felt like when you go to a place where God has been ushered in, where the Spirit of God is, that you should never leave the same. I always believe that. So I want you guys to do something for me, because I just want to see if this premise works. Let's just be some paper in front of you guys, a little notepad or something. There should be some pens on the paper. I want you to take a few seconds, and I want you to do what I call make a choice. I want you to make a choice. I want you to choose right now to forgive someone something that would take at least 2 pounds out of your 50-pound bag. I just want you to write that name down, and I want you to fold that paper up. I'm not asking you to say anything. I'm not asking you to do anything other than write that down. Because, see, what happens is when you making a choice, when you ask God to help you to open up and start to forgive, you are making a choice. You're making a choice. And that's the only way you can start. You have to continue. It's almost like if anybody ever has been, like I'll just say, back in the day, I guess it's Miller's Junior Draft. It's a Miller's Junior Draft, my 20s. And I've made the choice to stop. And every game that my husband had, every time they had the football game and he brought his Miller's Junior Draft in here, I continued to make the choice not to drink that. So with this making a choice, I need you guys to make this choice, and I'm going to pray with you guys. And we're going to have it. I really did have this. Is this cute? This is a seashell. And it actually kind of works with this. Carl, can you help me with this?
Sure.
What I would love you to do is go around and let them put this in the shell. And we're going to call this the Sea of Forgiveness. And we're going to pray that this thing no longer weighs on you. Okay? So did you guys give that to him? I will open it up for any questions.
Or I'll drink some water if you don't want any questions.
Forgiveness is a hard thing.
Good.
It is a hard thing. I understand that. But the choice to forgive, I think, weighs a lot easier than to continue to let it burn you down and bury you down.
What? You guys talk about forgiveness all the time and stuff. I look up to you. I don't know how you forgive a person like that. Goes along with his story, what he was talking about too, another thing. You talking about forgiving people? Forgiving what?
Yourself.
could you... Okay, about forgiving someone. What if you don't talk to them? Is that called forgiving them? If you don't talk to them, you don't have nothing to do with them. You know, you just...
So if you alienate your... If the person has hurt you...
Yes.
And you make the choice to just forget about them.
Yeah. You pretty much forgave them while you ain't going to talk to them.
Out of sight, out of mind?
Yes.
Is it really out of mind?
Well, now
it's out of mind.
Now it is.
Now, because you made the choice to forget about them?
No, he's dead.
Okay. You passed before you got a chance to ask God to give you the strength to forgive him. Because the thing about forgiveness is that it does not have to be. I would love to be able to walk up and use Linda as an example. She's never done anything to me. Let's say Linda stepped on my foot. And I would love to be able to go to her and say, Linda, you stepped on my foot. And then Linda says, I'm sorry. And then I say, I forgive you. But if Linda walks out here, she steps on my foot, and she walks out here and I never get to say that to her, I still have in my mind that Linda did something to me. So the weight and the burden is not on the other person. It's on you. You don't want to pick up the weight every morning, and you don't want to take the weight and just make it part of your lifestyle to the point where it's okay.
But it ain't a weight where you don't even think about it.
So can we be transparent here?
Oh, yeah.
Did you not think about it when he passed?
Think about
whatever
forgiving him?
Whatever he did to you that made you put him in the category of one to forgive him.
At that moment in time, yeah.
Okay, so it was still there. What we're very good with doing is covering things up, and it's okay. Listen, when you, if I had a rubber band, I can show you, but everybody knows what a rubber band does. Walking life, a rubber band. You're walking life.
Yes.
And you're walking life. Somebody does something to you. There's a pin put there. You hold that pin. Your life still goes on.
Yep.
But that pin, it's almost like the visual I gave the other night where you are walking and there's this time warp. You ever seen a movie where the person and then the time, everything's going by in time, you are still here. So that means that there's a gap in your life. Irregardless if the person ever says anything to you, you have to find the strength. You have to say to God, I want to remove this because I'm not living abundantly. I'm not. Because what you don't give to him, you'll put it on somebody else.
Now I got another question. Like that guy killed your daughter and he died too and everything. Comes back to what he was preaching about too. You guys, you know, forgive the past and stuff like that. What's so wrong with remembering the past so you can remember not to fall back in the same hole?
Well, you learn from the past. Yes. You're learning from the past. There's nothing wrong with that.
So you can remember.
You don't want to have a stranglehold. You don't want the past to have a stranglehold on your life that you can't keep going forward.
So the issue that I have with let me just say to that, I'm not sure. Well, I am sure because the initial person that hurt her is still alive and is still basking in glory and still on Facebook bragging. And, you know what I'm saying? So, but I made the choice to forgive him because I knew what it was doing to me.
Would you talk to him?
I would have to ask God about that. And I'm just being honest. I told you I'm trying.
Oh, yeah, yeah, you're being honest. I'm just saying.
I'm telling you what thus said the Lord about forgiveness. Okay? I'm not telling you that I'm the queen, forgive. I'm telling you that I've made the choice, which is what I want you guys to do. Because when you make the choice, you're saying to Satan, you have no hold on me about this. I'm not going to stay in the past. Now, if he walks up to me and says hi, I would love to believe that the God in me would unction a hi out of me. Would I invite him to dinner? I don't think so.
No, I want to keep it, but
I don't think so. But I think I can show him Christ. I'm going to truly believe that the faith walk that I have, I can show him Christ. But again, it's all about your walking. It's all about taking those steps. Forgiveness is not something you do, and it's not like a shower. You don't go in there, and I'm forgiven, and you shower, and you clean. No, if it's rooted in you, what I've learned from living out here in the, with the what do you call this, the rural area, and the country land and all of that, is that stuff, when it's rooted, it's deep down.
Yes, it is.
And if it's rooted in you, it's not anything that you chop off the top and it's gone. No, because anything that waters it, any type of fertilizer that gets on it will rekindle it and regrow it. So that's why you have to go in. That's why you have to daily ask God, forgive me as I forgive others. Forgive me as I forgive others.
So you forgive just once or?
70, the Bible says 70 times 7. Now let me say to you, if you step on my foot 71 times in that day, we might have to.
You got to forgive them.
Because we'll just take it over to the next day, because I promise you, if you step on my foot 3 times, I'm walking away from you. You ain't step on my foot no more. But no, so you want to develop patterns in your life that are healthy. And you have to do this, you're going to have to do it step by step. The first step is to acknowledge and recognize that it's there, and to acknowledge that you have the faith, you have the ability, because you trust God. You trust God.
I trust God.
I trust you, God. You said that if I give this to you, that you will take it off of me. So I'm going to give it to you. And now I need you to take it off of me. And know that it's going to come back up in your face. Know that. Please know that. I told God, okay, God, I want to forgive him. Okay, you know what? I'm going to forgive him. 2 days later, I saw someone on Facebook that said he went to jail. Poor Lynn. I was like, But then he got out of jail, and then things started happening good to him. And I was like, God, I had the wrong spirit. Forgive me. I had the wrong spirit. Because, you know, I'm not asking you to, I don't want to go through this and then watch something happen to them. That's not, because you know what? They still, you won't believe it. I know you can't digest it, but they are still God's children too.
No, I cannot digest it.
Take some time. I love you so much. I really do. I love your honesty, your transparency. So what we're going to do with this is, because I don't want to keep you guys any longer than what we have, we're going to say a prayer over this. And if anybody has one that they didn't turn it in, that's okay. Take yours and fold it up, and we have the garbage can in the back. But we're going to release, I'm going to ask God to release his power over you guys, so that as you are taking this step, that you take one, he takes 50 for you. I'm asking him not to just take one of those bricks out of your backpack, to take them all out. And I'm asking him to begin to show you, because everything that we want him to do, we want him to get the glory for it. So why? So you can go and brag about him. You can go tell somebody else. I can tell you that I forgave him, and I can tell you, I can say it with a smile. His name was Timmy, and the other guy's name was Tony. I can say their names, and it doesn't bother me. I couldn't do that once upon a time. You know what I'm saying? So it's one of those things that you have to take the steps and allow God to take the pain away from you. So if you want to repeat after me, you can. If not, I'm going to pray that God covers and does what he does with this. Dear God, today I need you to give me the strength to let it go. I make the decision to forgive. Not because the pain was not real, or even because it does not still cut at me. Even because it still doesn't cut at me. But because I refuse to continue to allow yesterday's pain to steal my joy for today. I choose to forgive so that I can live abundantly according to God's will for my life. And we're going to say amen at that, guys.
Amen.
Now, you have let this in here. We're going to release it. Faith is action. You showed your action by putting it in here. And I'm going to continue to pray that God takes this off of you so that you can live life abundantly. Forgiveness, you have to let it work. We're going to ask God to just let you guys live abundantly. I'm going to throw these in the garbage if you all don't mind. I'm going to throw them in the garbage. You guys, you can hear the letter song.